Welcome to another edition of Armchair Preacher. Would open you up your Bibles to Revelation 21. Revelation 21, planning on covering verses 7 through 14 in this lesson. The name of I titled this New Jerusalem and Its Inhabitants. We saw back in verse 2, it says, I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And this verse here, this passage here that we're going to cover, verses 7 through 14, talks about who's going to be in New Jerusalem, and then it gives a little description of it. And that goes along with the governmental structure that God has for His earthly kingdom. So that's what we'll be going over today. Your first point, notice in verse 3, when it talks about New Jerusalem, at first it talks about it corporately. It talks about it as a whole, the group of people. It says there in verse 3, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God. So you can see they, there, you know, it says with men, dwell with them, they shall be His people. God will be with them. He will be their God. So it's talking about the group. And then when we get down to verse 6, then we see Jesus talking a little bit about, well, how do you join the group? You know, it's sort of like you've got, say, a membership in AARP. Well, you know, that's a group of people that have certain benefits and privileges, but it's made up of individuals who are part of that group. And you have to meet certain requirements to get part of that group. So that's what Jesus is doing here with the bride of Christ, the saved nation of Israel. The group as a whole is going to be with God. God's going to be with them. They'll be His people, and He will be their God. And He will dwell with them in New Jerusalem and Mount Zion there. Now look in verse 6, and we're going to see how you get part of that group. He says there in verse 6, He said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. So we ended with that last time. And that verse there tells you that the invitation is to all. So in other words, you don't have to be over 50 like AARP. Or you don't have to make a certain level of income like a lot of membership groups. Or go through initiation things or anything like that. He says the offer is to everybody. And now we're going to see, well, you know, how do you get it? Obviously, not everybody is in New Jerusalem. We've just read the Great White Throne Judgment, or I said probably about 100 billion people are going to be thrown to the lake of fire. They don't get to be a part of this. So, you know, how do you get in there? And so verse 7, he tells you that. He says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. So back in verse 3, it said, God Himself shall be with them and be their God. Here it says, I will be His God and He shall be my son. So what it's talking about there, your first fill in the blank, chapter 21, verse 3 talks about Israel corporately. 21, verse 7 talks about Israel individually. Talks about individually. Rather than using them, their, they, it says, His God and He shall be my son. So it's individually. So the answer, the offer is to all, and the way that you be a part of this is that you overcome. When you overcome, then you inherit all things. I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Well, you may think, well, how does that happen? If you remember when we first started the Revelation series, Revelation chapters 2 and 3, there are the seven churches. In fact, let's go there. There are the messages to the seven churches. And the theme of overcoming keeps coming up. At the end of every letter or message to each of these churches, he tells them, if you overcome, you're going to be part of that kingdom. And he talks about different aspects. Chapter 2, verse 7, the first church, Ephesus. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So they're going to be in the kingdom if they overcome. The second church, Smyrna, verse 11, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. The third church, Pergamos, verse 17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. Then the fourth church, Thyatira, down in verse 26. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. So they're in the kingdom, ruling over the Gentiles. Chapter 3 now, the church of Sardis, and verse 5. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. We read that last message. The sixth church, Philadelphia, verse 12, chapter 3, verse 12. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. And then the seventh church, Laodicea, and verse 21, chapter 3, verse 21. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. So you can see when Jesus starts the book of Revelation, the messages of the seven churches, all of them have the promise, if you overcome, you'll be part of the kingdom. And it talks about, each one talks about a certain aspect of it. Bottom line is, you get to be part of the kingdom. So overcoming is the theme. And now we see that again, now we're in chapter 21, verse 7, when the kingdom actually comes down, New Jerusalem comes down from heaven. He says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things. So the answer to get part of the kingdom, to be an individual that's part of the bigger group, the body of Christ, or the bride of Christ, I should say, the bride of Christ in New Jerusalem, the way you do it is you overcome. You say, well, how do you do it? At the beginning he says to overcome. At the end he says, if you overcome, you'll be part of it. Well, the answer of what overcoming is found in the middle of the book, chapter 12. Go to Revelation chapter 12. Verse 10. Revelation 12, verse 10. Talking about God's kingdom coming. It says there, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren, that's Satan, is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Now verse 11 is going to tell you how they overcame. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. The blood of the Lamb is representative of the faith of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ had faith in the Father's plan that if he obeyed the law perfectly, lived a perfect life, was obedient to the Father in all things, then if he would go to the cross and die on that cross, then his blood is pure blood, and it serves as the substitutionary sacrifice. It's the atoning blood for all those who have faith in what God tells them to have faith in. So it's the blood of the Lamb that cleanses them. If it's just the blood of the Lamb, if it's only that, then everybody's going to be saved because he died for all. He gave his life a ransom for all. 1 Timothy 2, 6 tells you that. But you have to accept that free gift of eternal life. And that's the last part of this. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. In other words, look over in 1 John 1. This passage, 1 John 1, people will bring it up all the time and say you need to confess your sins. If not, you're not going to be saved. And it's really talking about the nation of Israel as a whole. We don't have time to go into that because we're not there in 1 John. Really, it has to do with the promises that God made to Israel under those covenant promises. And that he said, if you break the law, if you confess, then you know I will heal you, I will forgive you. That's mentioned. Hold 1 John 1. Let's look at Leviticus 26. We'll look at both of these so you can see. Last week we went over the blessings that are found under the law covenant if they obeyed it. The rest, that was the first 13 verses in Leviticus 26. Well, then the last part, verses 14 through 46, have to do with the curses that are under the law. And notice, so they were all under the curse because they all sinned, come short of the glory of God. All of them disobeyed the law. Notice what it says, and this is under the law covenant with Israel. It's not for us today. It's not, God did not make this covenant with us today. This is Israel's program. It says there in verse 40, Leviticus 26, verse 40, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. And eventually, bring them into the land. So you can see there, it's specifically Israel's covenant, the covenant made with Jacob, with Isaac, with Abraham. He's made a covenant to give them the land. And that's what we're talking about in Revelation 21, New Jerusalem. But you notice in verse 40, if they shall confess their iniquity. So part of their salvation, not to us today, God did not promise us New Jerusalem. He did not come to, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is that nation of Israel. We're not part of that today as the body of Christ. So confession is part of their salvation here. In other words, confess that they've sinned as a nation as a whole, then the nation as a whole gets that land. So 1 John 1:9, that's what they're talking about here. People use this today. It's really a reference to that Leviticus 26 passage. 1 John 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Again, you can see the group there. If we confess our sins, forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So when we go back to verse 11 now in Revelation 12, the second part then is their confession. It's their belief. If they believe in the provisions that God made under the law covenant to save them through the sacrifice of the blood of the Lamb and to bring them into the kingdom, that's when their belief in that is going to result in a confession. That's why when Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father. In other words, they're going to have the opportunity to confess. They're going to have to, Jesus said He's going to divide father against mother and brother against sister. There's going to come a time when the nation of Israel, the believing remnant of Israel, is going to have to make the decision to distance itself from the apostate nation of Israel. Early in Revelation, He said, come out from among them. He says, do not be partakers of that apostate nation, Babylon. Don't be part of that. Come out from them. So they need to confess their belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and really the law covenant that God's made with them, that He will provide, that His provision by the blood of the Lamb is what will save them and bring them into the kingdom rather than their own obedience of the law. That's what that's referring to there in Revelation 12:11, when it says, they overcame Him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And that also involves having to go before the Antichrist in some cases and saying that I'll go ahead and have let you kill me, but I'm not going to deny that God is going to save me through the law covenant, which is why the rest of the verse says, and they love not their lives unto the death. So overcoming for the nation of Israel has to do with distancing themselves from the apostate nation, the unbelieving Israel, and there's this group, this Israel of God, as Galatians 6:16 calls them, that distance themselves from the unbelieving nation, and they confess their sins and trust in God's provisions under the law covenant to save them rather than their own self-righteousness. So it's the blood of the Lamb, that sacrifice that God made according to that law covenant, and then their faith in that, the word of their testimony. That's how they overcome. And then, as a result then, when they do that, at the second coming here, after the tribulation period is over, then it says in Revelation 21:7, "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." So it's only after the Antichrist and his kingdom is taken down by the Lord Jesus Christ at his second coming that they then become sons of God. Because you can see that everything in Revelation 21:7 is future tense. "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." That's different from the body of Christ today. Again, different promises given to us, so it's a little different. I wrote on your outline that Israel becomes heirs and sons of God at Jesus' second coming, but the body of Christ today, in today's dispensation, becomes heirs and sons of God at the moment of belief. Look over in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And verse 8. Romans 5, 8. "But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So there's the blood of the Lamb. Now verse 9. "Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." At verse 11, "Not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement." Thus, that's present tense. It doesn't say like Revelation 21:7. It doesn't say, well, if you overcome, then I will be his God. He shall be my son. It doesn't say that. It says, now justified by his blood, now received the atonement. The blood of the Lamb is immediately applied. We receive the atonement right away. We become sons of God. We inherit all things once we have the belief. We believe in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for our sins. Look over in Romans 8. "Since we already have received the atonement, we are already sons of God." Romans 8:14. Romans 8:14. "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." We have been adopted as sons and daughters of God. The guarantee of that is the Holy Spirit that's been given to us, and it's the Holy Spirit that cries through our sonship status, it cries, Abba, Father. He is already our Father, dear Father. Verse 16, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." So there's the inherit all things there that it talks about in Revelation 21:7. He says, "He that overcomes shall inherit all things. I will be his God. He shall be my son." We see today, for the body of Christ, once we trust in the blood of Christ as atonement for our sins, we already have that. We are already his sons. We have the Holy Spirit. We cry, Abba, Father. And because we are already adopted as sons, then we are heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. And, of course, Christ inherits all things, so we too, as part of the body of Christ, inherit all things. So, just an important dispensational distinction here. But now, to get back to where we are here, Revelation 21, we'll move on to verse 8. For Israel, that only happens at the second coming. They have to overcome the Antichrist and his kingdom, separate from that system. And then when the Lord Jesus Christ destroys them, since the Antichrist and his kingdom, if they have endured unto the end in overcoming, then they will be part of the bride, part of New Jerusalem. Verse 8 now, Revelation 21, 8. So in verse 7, he says, "He that overcomes shall inherit all things. I will be his God, and he shall be my son." Verse 8 says, "But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Important to note, and what people do is they'll take this verse. There are a couple of other times in the Bible where there's a group of a list of people who do sins, this type of thing, and they're told they shall not inherit the kingdom of God. And what people, almost 99 out of 100 times, what pastors, Christians, what churches, denominations will do is they'll say, "Well, you see, you had the faith and you're saved, but you have to have the works that follow it." You know, in other words, if you are a murderer, you can't be, you lose your salvation. You've got to have works that follow it. Your point on your outline here is those with faith in God, those with faith in what God has told them, are not part of this group. It doesn't matter what you've done once you've come to have faith in God's provision. You are not part of this group. And we're going to get into why that is, what that's talking about. First thing to note is, a lot of times, you know, people will use the example of, say, murderers, and they'll say, you know, well, and it goes down there, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, liars. Well, a lot of people lie, so they'll say, well, what if I lie one time? You know, am I a liar? Well, they'll say, no, because they recognize everybody lies at some point, so then everybody's going to lose their salvation. So then they'll say, well, you got to be a habitual liar. You know, you got to do it all the time. Then you lose your salvation. But they won't do that with murderers. I mean, is it okay if I murder somebody, say, murder one person a week? I mean, that standard would be okay under the lying thing. You know, I lie once a week. You know, that's not too bad compared to most other people. So, you know, I'm not a habitual liar if I only do it once a week. So how about murdering? You know, can I do that once a week? You know, kill 50 people a year on average, you know, maybe a little less than a week, one a week, maybe, you know, 25. Let's do one every other. I'll kill one every other week. I'll only kill 25 people a year. You know, that's pretty good, isn't it? Well, no, they've, you know, of course, with that, they'll say, you murder somebody once, you're a murderer. Yeah, obviously, that's what it's talking about. If you murder somebody once, you're a murderer. If you lie then once, you are a liar. Doesn't matter how many times you do it. You do it once, that's who you are. You know, sorcerer, idolater, you worship an idol once, you're an idolater. The point is that everybody does these things. Even if you don't physically kill somebody, Jesus said if you hate your brother, you've broken the commandment, thou shalt not kill. So the point is that everybody has done this, and so your next fill in the blank there is if they were. In other words, if people who have faith, if they have to have keep from doing anything in this list in order to make the kingdom, if they were, no one would have eternal life. No one would have eternal life. So let's look at a couple of verses. Really what it's talking about is the idea of faith versus your own works. So in verse 7, the ones that overcome, it's not that they live perfectly. It's that they trust in God's provision under the law of covenant to bring them into the kingdom. Sure, they sin. They lie. They have hatred for their brother. I mean, think about it. A lot of them fall in that murderer category. I mean, if you've got the Antichrist and apostate Israel, and they're killing people who are members of the little flock, people you went to, you saw, and you got together as a group and studied the Bible last Sunday, and one guy, you know, Joe isn't there. He said, well, where's Joe? Well, he got captured and he was beheaded by the Antichrist. How many of those people of the little flock love the Antichrist? Probably none of them. They probably wish that he was dead. So all of them are murderers in that they hate the Antichrist. The same thing with the people under them, the top Pharisees. You know, they're murderers by hating them. And yeah, that's a natural thing. I mean, you're killing off my good friends here, the people that I love. You know, I'm going to hate you for doing that. So it's not that they're sinless, not that they're perfect. It's just that there are two groups of people, those who are in Christ, who trust in God to save them, and then the other group of people, those who trust in their own righteousness. That's what this group is here, the fearful. Notice the second thing there in verse 8, it's unbelieving. They do not believe in God's law covenant to save them. They're trusting in their own righteousness. But let's look at a couple verses here. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 6. For you to see this, Paul gives a similar list in 1 Corinthians, and then he specifically says, you're not part of this. You're not one of these people. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. All of these Corinthians, they're guilty of these things. You know, the first thing is fornicator. The chapter before, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, you have a man committing fornication with his stepmother. And they're all think it's great. You've got here chapter 6, in the first 8 verses, it talks about going to law against your brethren, defrauding each other there. Chapters 8 through 10 talks about eating food sacrificed to idols. Chapter 11 talks about how they don't prefer other brethren, that they, when they get to the Lord's Supper, they take food and they get drunk and they make themselves merry and they keep other people from even getting a bite. Chapters 12 through 14, you see them abusing the spiritual gifts. Chapter 15, they stop believing in the resurrection of Christ. Chapter 16, they had promised to make a gift to the poor saints in Jerusalem, and they haven't come through. I mean, certainly, if you're going to judge the Corinthians by their works, they are in this category. Fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, you know, this whole list. It says these people shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It says, verse 9, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But what does Paul say to these group of people who are doing these things? Notice verse 11, 1 Corinthians 6, 11. And such were some of you, past tense. You're no longer fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminate. You're no longer these things. And you may say, well, of course they are. We just read in chapter 5 of the fornication that this man is committing. We read in chapter 6 of the defrauding of their brethren. We read in chapter 11 of them keeping food from each other. We read in chapter 16 of how they lied, saying they were going to give a gift and they didn't do it. Paul isn't looking. The point is, God, because they have placed their faith in Jesus Christ, God no longer looks at their works. They're in the faith program. So verse 11 says, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. And then in verse 12, he even goes on to say, all things are lawful unto me. So here we've got a list of people who will not inherit the kingdom of God that is given to a group of people who are doing the things in this list. And yet, Paul says, you were like that. But you're not like that anymore. And you say, well, Paul, what do you mean? Yes, they are. We see their sins here. He says, you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified. So it's important to note, when we get a list like this in Revelation 21, 8, and he says, people who do these things, they're going to have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. He's not talking about the believers. Those who have faith in what God has told them, in this case, the law of covenant, the provision that God has made in that law of covenant, those people are not included in this list. They are overcomers. Do they do the things in verse 8? Sure they do. You know, there is some unbelief in them and some sound doctrine they're not believing. There is some hatred that is murdering in the heart in there. There is some idolatry in there. They are liars. You know, certainly they're doing these things.